Season's greetings, mortals. Welcome to another session of the Infernal Court in Musical Hell. I'm Diva, your judge, jury, executioner, and all of the other reindeer. You know, mortals, it says something about you when one of the most beloved icons of your celebration of peace, love, and togetherness is just a big marketing scheme. No, not him. I am referring to Rudolph, that most famous reindeer of all whose origins are entirely rooted in a department store's simple wish to make more money. In 1939, Montgomery Ward had a promotional gimmick of giving away coloring books to children during the holiday season. When they decided they could save money by making their own coloring books instead of buying them, they charged copywriter Robert L. May with the task of creating one. The result was a story of a little reindeer whose bright red nose was a source of derision until he found employment as Santa's fog lamp. A popular song, a classic Rankin-Bass holiday special, and a ton of ridiculous merchandise followed. But none more ridiculous than the 1998 animated feature adaptation of Rudolph's Tale. Loosely based on the Rankin-Bass version, this adaptation of Rudolph was the first feature film produced by Good Times Entertainment, a company whose previous work, unsurprisingly, consisted almost entirely of direct-to-video animated mockbusters. But the only things that distinguish this movie from its predecessors are a few celebrity voices and having been released in theaters for a few weeks in October. Yes, October. As for the rest, well, pour yourself a double dose of eggnog as we examine the case of Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, the movie. Inevitably, the movie kicks off with a rendition of the famous song, performed by the Auntie Mame version of the Disney fairies.
Comet and Cupid and Donner and Blitzen, but do you recall the most famous reindeer of all?
Winged supernatural creatures singing about a portentous birth in a stable. Whatever you do, just don't tell Bill O'Reilly about this movie, okay? We'd never hear the end of it. Rudolph's parents in this version are Blitzen and Mitzi, and they deal with their newborn's peculiar snout by standing around while the entire chorus mocks him in song. Doing? Is that dancing? Tai Chi? Did someone put icicles down their shirts? The movie's first sin, the animation is terrible. Forget comparing it to other animated feature films, this stuff wouldn't pass muster on an afternoon kids show. The movement is spastic, the facial expressions are limited, the coloring is inconsistent, the backgrounds are unimaginative, and the whole thing looks like the Korean outsourced knockoff it is. At least the Rankin-Bass specials had kind of a weird charm to their stiff stop-motion selves. This is just awful. So, time for an inciting incident, courtesy of a pair of mailroom elves named Boone and Doggle.
You mean we won't be picking up the mail anymore?
That's small potatoes for exceptional elves like us.
Oh, sweet Lucifer, I know that voice.
Hi! Hi! Hi, everybody!
The Third Circle really outdid themselves with that guy. But Richard Simmons' voice is surprisingly one of the least annoying aspects of Boone, who is one of many examples of Sin Number 2, the lousy original characters. Of course you need to expand the cast and story of Rudolph if you're going to make a feature film of it, but must the characters be so stupid? Let's begin, as the movie does, with the slapstick duo of Boone and Doggle, specifically Boone, who is a puffed-up jerk, and a pretty despicable one, as evidenced when he loses control of the mail truck. You'd think North Pole elves would know how to drive on ice, destroys a sculpture garden, and runs like a coward from the scene, which ends up incurring the wrath of the garden's owner and our next awful character, the villain Stormella. Accompanied by a penguin butler, yes, I know it and you know it, but the movie doesn't. Stormella is voiced by Whoopi Goldberg, as every character Whoopi Goldberg ever played. I'm sorry, but Goldberg's persona just doesn't say Ice Queen to me.
How do you know our elves are responsible?
Duh! Because I found this at the scene of the crime! Hello!
Rounding out this parade of supporting cast pain will be a wannabe Timon and Pumbaa pairing consisting of Leonard, a dumb polar bear voiced by Bob Newhart, and Slyly, an Arctic fox with a dodgy Brooklyn accent voiced by Eric Idle. Did I read that right? I did. Wonder how that pitch meeting went. Who should we get to voice the stereotypical New York tough guy? I know, how about a member of the quintessential British comedy troupe? Brilliant! Slyly and Leonard are a poor excuse for comic relief, but at least they have the decency to stay out of the story for about half the film, which is more than I can say for the rest of the cast. Stormella is understandably cranky that someone went and destroyed her personal property, and even more cranky when Santa shows no interest in punishing the offenders. So much for the whole naughty and nice thing, I guess. So Stormella decides to take matters into her own hands.
I'll close my ice bridge to the public.
But Stormella, your bridge is the only way across Grand Chasm. If you close it, we'll be cut off.
Gee, if only somebody had a bunch of flying animals who don't need to bother with land routes, this wouldn't be a problem. But the ice bridge is off limits, and Stormella vows to bury the North Pole in a Christmas-canceling blizzard if anyone tries to cross it. Which she's hoping will happen anyway, because she wants an excuse to mess with old Saint Nick. Why?
And it's because I hate Santa Claus, that chief of Santa Claus.
What, you want characters with interesting and well-realized motivations? Watch a Pixar movie. The singing exposition fairies move things forward a year to Rudolph's first day of school, where all of the other, oh, you know how it goes.
Hey, Ruddy, try the circus instead!
Ruddy the red-nosed reject ain't ever gonna be a flyer!
This is the part where Rudolph burns down the prom, right? The only reindeer who's nice to Rudolph is token love interest Zoe, even though she's dating token bully Arrow because it creates conflict. And Santa, being Santa, has a few kind words as well.
We're all different on the outside, son. But what counts, young buck? What really counts is what's inside our hearts.
The jolly old elf explains this philosophy in Sin Number 3, Santa's Family. I can describe everything wrong with this song in three words. John Goodman singing.
So don't look so glum, my little reindeer chum. Everybody counts, in small and great amounts. In small and great amounts.
It's also weird that the elves are being all consider yourself our mate with Rudolph now when they were happily making fun of him earlier. But the whole thing puts Rudolph in a good mood for Santa's Christmas Eve.
Your father looks so handsome in his harness.
Oh, no. No, please, Lucifer, Beelzebub, and all the unholy powers, anything but... I don't care if an ex-Beatle wrote it. This is the vilest, most horrific torment ever visited upon crowds of holiday shoppers. Okay, except for maybe Christmas shoes. It's a dopey, saccharine piece built around an incessant two-note riff and a grating sing-song melody. And worst of all, it is a weapons-grade earworm. It never goes away. Never! When the planet Earth is a smoking husk with nothing but microbes living upon it, those microbes will be throwing themselves into the lava pits just to end the simply having a wonderful Christmas time! Damn you, Paul McCartney! Damn you to here! Anyway. So another year or so passes. This movie has more time jumps than Doctor Who. And it's time for the reindeer games, the day when all the young bucks and does get to show off for Santa and hope to get picked for his flying team. Even though he hasn't made any changes to the lineup since Clement Clark Moore. In order to heighten the romantic tension, Zoe gives Rudolph her collar for luck.
Hey, she's my doe, understand?
She's not a trophy, and you shouldn't treat her like one.
Even though that's exactly what the movie treats her like. During the sleigh pull, Arrow races like he's the bad guy in Ben-Hur, but he gets Rudolph disqualified by goading his nose into going off at a bad time.
You're disqualified for illegal use of a glowing red nose!
But...
you're banned from the rest of the games!
Come on now, I don't think Santa is going to stand for that.
Oh, say... just not fair.
But Mama, the judge has the final decision, not us.
Are you kidding me? You're Santa Claus. You're like the flippin' God King of the North Pole. You pass judgment on all the children in the world, and you can't do anything about an unfair race? Actually, you know what? It's not your fault. It's the fault of sin number 5, the lack of logic and consistency in character behaviors. I can't even call this an idiot plot because the characters act in ways that are worse than stupid. They're completely arbitrary. I mean, why is Zoe even dating Arrow to begin with? She spends most of her time with Rudolph, and it's obvious she likes him more. There are girls who will go for a bad boy, but she doesn't seem like the type. Her behavior exists solely to create a conflict. And speaking of conflict, why does Stormella have to wait for someone to go trip-trapping across her bridge in order to carry out her vendetta against Santa? If she doesn't like him and wants to mess with his whole gift-giving routine, why doesn't she just do it? I know better than most that even evil has to follow the rules sometimes, but you need to establish what those rules are first. This story makes no sense. And don't try pulling that, but it's just a kids' movie crap. That's a lazy excuse used by greedy people who want to get as much money from parents' pockets with as little effort as they can, and you know it is. The fallout from all this is that Rudolph decides to run away from home, singing a sad little song as he does.
I'm out here on my own, to face the day alone.
Whoa, did Rudolph hit puberty all of a sudden? Sin number 6 for the mismatched vocal doubles. Come on, this isn't even close.
I'm sure he'll notice you too, Zoe.
Lost out in the cold, I want someone to hold.
And Zoe's double for the song isn't much better.
Oh, beyond the mountaintop, the dream will never stop.
Yeah, I'm really glad we're friends.
It's like they wanted to make this song sound like a breakout pop single and cast the voices based on that with no consideration to how they fit with the characters. Which just goes to show the sheer level of indifference that went into this movie. So while slyly serenades Rudolph with a G-rated version of Always Look on the Bright Side of Life,
yes, things could be better in this big universe, but remember it could always be worse.
Zoe goes off to search for him and decides the most logical place to start would be on the other side of Stormella's ice bridge. Because let's face it, this damsel ain't going to distress herself.
Poor Zoe, nowhere to run.
Meanwhile, Santa decides to get off his fat bowl full of jelly and order a search for the missing reindeer. Well, that's a good idea. I mean, the flying sleigh would be a good reconnaissance unit, and he probably has some kind of sees-you-when-you're-sleeping, knows-when-you're-awake tech that, Or you could just send the 2 stupidest elves in the North Pole to go look for them. Good call, Santa. You probably would have put the 3 Stooges on SEAL Team 6. At the same time, Rudolph has hooked up with Slyly and Leonard, and the exposition fairies show up to explain that Zoe's in trouble, and he can help if he learns to focus his special talent. I think I'd put glowing nose somewhere between talking to fish and always slightly damp on the lousy superpower list. Slyly, being the sneaky coward type, stays behind, while Leonard and Rudolph make their way into Stormella's realm. They'd better hurry, because no doubt she's getting ready to unleash her... Come on, I know demons on the sloth beat more active than you. On the other hand, Rudolph and Leonard are so ridiculously easy to capture that she still has time for a villain song.
I married that old gizzard in a wizard of a blizzard, and it's because I hate Santa Claus.
Not again, switch to anything.
I take it back!
So after Stormella finally unleashes the blizzard works, Slyly gets his Han Solo moment and steals the key to the prison, even though the bars were put into place by magic and don't have, oh, never mind. The heroes maintain their standards of effectiveness by getting a whole 20 feet before Stormella catches up with them.
Leave her alone!
And what are you gonna do about it?
Ha! That's a pretty sad villain epitaph. Here lies Stormella, glowed to death. But this is one of those kids' movies that doesn't even have the horns to off the bad guy, so Rudolph saves Stormella's life, which for some reason means that she has to grant him a wish now. So he could wish for the blizzard to end, or for Santa to have a safe journey, or...
I want you to be nice.
Ooh, cute little penguin.
Oh, sure, but when we do it, it's called brainwashing. Stormella's forced conversion, sin number 7. Forget the shaky morality of the whole issue, it is an abrupt and unsatisfactory way of dealing with your bad guy. If you want to go all touchy-feely redemption, that's one thing. It is a Christmas movie, after all. But you can't just drop it in without developing it from an understandable place. Imagine if Dickens wrote like that. Bah, humbug! Christmas is a waste of time and money! Gee, Mr. Scrooge, I wish you could be more generous and kinder toward your fellow man. Oh, Merry Christmas! Heaven and the Deus Ex Machina be praised! But despite having her brain forcibly rewired on her, Stormella can't stop the blizzard once it's started. On the other hand, considering that everyone is able to casually drive home, it's not such a terrible storm at all. Really, Santa looks like kind of a wimp for not wanting to go out in it. But we all know how it goes. Rudolph gets to guide the sleigh, he gets a medal and a kiss from Zoe, Blitzen is proud of his son, Arrow just kind of disappeared from the story, everyone has a Merry Christmas, and Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer goes down in bad movie history. The worst part of Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, the movie, is the level of apathy it represents. It's not just that it lacks imagination and quality, it's that nobody cared enough to provide any, and probably didn't think the kids in the audience would know the difference. That makes for a very depressing movie. And when you think about it, Rudolph is kind of a depressing story to begin with. It basically says that people will only accept your peculiarities if they can exploit them. Otherwise, they'll just shove you onto a cramped expansion shelf with no heating or vending machines and make you watch an endless parade of terrible musicals just to remind you that you failed at everything else you've ever... Great. Now see what you've done, movie? That's it. I am ordering the worst punishment I can imagine for everyone involved in this film.
Simply having a wonderful Christmas time.
Yes, suffer the fury of hell and merry fucking Christmas.
The party's on, the feeling's here. That only comes this time of year. Simply